Welcome to the pew.
Igor doesn't tell us when he's actually turning on the camera,
so we have to say welcome to the pew five times.
That's not true.
You just heard Igor. Oh my god. Okay.
So bit by bit, he's horning his way into our show.
Yeah,
at first, he wanted
anything to do with the show. I don't even want it filmed in my apartment. Oh. Sorry, David.
Hi.
So, first thing.
Bleep my name out.
Okay.
It's okay.
So the first.
The viewers can hear you, Igor.
I know.
Okay.
Hi, viewers. Mm-hmm.
Okay. So, the first thing we were.
Michael wanted to talk about the quality of drag queens on RuPaul's Drag Race, the logo TV network show, versus queens from the Pyramid Club in the 80s, or the queens from the drag house balls, or the ones from Warhol's factory.
Yes, because they're all different kinds of drag queens.
Right, so we were having this deep conversation about drag queens and which ones were better, or are they just simply incomparable?
Yeah, I don't think you can compare them because it's apples and oranges, they're different things.
But you were comparing them. You were saying that you thought that some of them weren't that good.
I didn't say they weren't that good. I said they were all the same.
The ones... Okay, so which drag queens do you think are all the same, and what do you mean by that?
Well, the drag queens at a place like the Pyramid or even Warhol's drag queens were very unique character geniuses, really. I mean, like, every drag queen at the Pyramid, with the exception of maybe one or two, were, I think, geniuses. I mean, Sister mentioned Lady Bunny, Happy Face. I mean, they were all extremely intelligent. They had very strong personas. They were, satirical. They were funny. They were, and then when you look at a lot of the drag queens on some of these shows that we're talking about.
Well, we're talking about one show.
Which one?
RuPaul's Drag Race.
Oh, RuPaul's Drag Race.
There's no other show that has drag queens.
They're kind of, I don't know, maybe Drag Race gone too mainstream. I mean, there can only be so many geniuses and characters, so I mean.
Well, there have been a lot of quirky drag queens on RuPaul's Drag Race.
But haven't you noticed the quirky element kind of diminishing?
No, I think that every season of RuPaul's Drag Race, you do see one to three very quirky drag queens, but then you also see very conventional, like, pageant queens.
Yes,
and you're referring, the ones that you don't like are the pageant queens.
Right.
The ones that, are trying to look like
female impersonators almost.
And they're kind of like very beauty queen types of drag queens, and they're not.
And they had that typical drag queen makeup that I just.
They're not our kind of drag queens.
They're not our kind of drag queens.
Because we go for the freak drag queens.
Yes. Or the
quirky, crazy drag queens that are not really trying to look like women. And
well, there's the ones that
never could.
Right. And the ones at the Pyramid were almost satires of drag queens.
Well, they were not even satires of drag queens. They were like satires of certain cultures, or they were always trying to make some type of joke. Like Taboo was always doing, this Armenian shtick where he was parodying like Armenia and Cher.
But in their femininity, they were almost satirizing the femininity of these other kind of pageant queens.
I guess. I don't know. I really don't see any comparison between Happy Face and any pageant queen.
No, that's
queen.
Why. There is just, you can't. There is no.
I mean, he was just...
Right.
If anything, he was trying to be like Bob Barker, like a TV...
Yeah, well, that's what I mean.
TV,
by character, like
a game show host.
Yeah, they each had their a character, a personality, and they're really... I don't notice personality in these pageant queens. It's really all about their eye makeup. And who wants to be friends with anybody who only cares about eye makeup?
We'll think
about that after this break.
And now a word from our sponsor.
Welcome back to the pew.
Welcome.
And now, this time, Ernie's going to call our viewers bitches.
Bitches want to know.
What do they want to know?
Well, Michelle Brooks wants to know Are you upset about Freeze getting out before you, and do you think it was fair?
No.
Well, first of all, how? When did he get out versus when you got out?
Oh, I think he had out like 2.5 years earlier than I did.
2.5?
I think so. Something like that. Was I upset? I think upset is the wrong word. I was not upset. I was jealous, I suppose, because he got to go home. I do think it was fair because he didn't have dirty urns the way I did.
You have to explain what dirty urine is.
Okay. Well, when they test your urine in prison, and if your urine tests positive for a drug, they put you in solitary confinement for a year, which I think is outrageous, but they do. In fact, they take you out of a drug. Instead of putting you in a drug program, they take you out of a drug program if you test positive and put you in solitary confinement. Freeze didn't get caught using drugs. Because of that reason, I think...
Because he wasn't using them, right?
Right. But because he didn't get caught, I do think it was fair. I mean, that's how they judge when you go home.
I think a lot of people are wanting to know, like, why were you using drugs in prison? Like, didn't you just want to get out as soon as possible?
No, I didn't. In fact, in the beginning... And really, up until March 31st, 2009, I remember the exact date, I felt like, I mean, I've said this a million times before, I felt like I was going to come home to nothing. I felt like nobody would forgive me for what I'd done. I would never forgive myself. I would never be happy because of that. I was approaching middle age, and I felt sort of like it was over, and why bother? I really felt like I had nothing to look for. I never thought that anybody would be interested in me coming home. I never thought that there'd be, a move, before the movie came out. I didn't think there'd be a movie. I didn't think there'd be all these books and documentaries and all the media. I just didn't. And I was in solitary confinement for a long time, so I didn't know a lot of it was going on, unless somebody would send it to me in a letter. And a lot of times, nobody would send them to me in a letter because they thought everybody else was sending them to me in a letter. So I didn't get anything. So I didn't know. So it wasn't until my therapist explained to me, and I can't believe that I needed her to explain it to me, but she did, but I did. She said that if you stop using drugs, all of those things will happen again. And I didn't believe her. So I would stop, and in a month, all of those things weren't happening to me because, I wanted things happening fast right away, and then I would start again. And, it just was stop. And, she explained to me that it would happen, and it was almost a dare. I dared her. I said, well, I'm going to stop, and I'm going to show you. None of those things are going to happen. And, in fact, she was right, so... And the feelings did come back. I didn't think that, I thought that I would change permanently. I thought that heroin especially had changed me permanently, like physiologic, my brain structure, that I could never be happy again. Once you reach a certain level of happiness, you feel like nothing can compare to that. So I felt like I would never be happy again. So I kind of felt like I had no reason to.
Well, it's a paradox because you were abusing all this heroin, and for you, you thought that was the happiest time of your life?
No, that's the paradox. Is the thing that you think will make you happy and that you think will fix everything is actually the thing that ruins everything.
A warning. About the dangers of heroin.
About the dangers of heroin.
Bye.
And I keep repeating everything you say.